All right, so we will be in Acts chapter 4, and what we'll be doing is we'll cover, and then hopefully next week Jim can continue in Acts chapter 4. What we're doing this in our study of Acts is elders are coming in and taking turns. Who's already taught? How many of you guys know? No, Steve, come on. You're not supposed to tell. Tom, you're not supposed to tell. So we've had Tom come in, we've had Steve, and we've had Neil. And then next week will be Pastor Jim. And then the week following will be Joel, the next 2 weeks. And then, who is it next? Is it Nick coming in next? Probably. Let's just be honest, it's probably, yeah. And then we'll jump into it again. So how many of you guys have been blessed so far by the study? Yeah, me too. I don't get to come in here, but we video it, and I get to watch all of them, so it's pretty cool to see. Like Pastor David said, there's tons of people here who can teach the Bible, and actually everybody in the seat can, you know. All it takes is just opening your mouth and proclaiming what God's already shown you, so cool. Let's do this. Let's read Acts chapter 4. It's a good chapter, and we're not going to read the whole thing. Just up to a little bit, but let's do this. Here goes, Acts chapter 4, verse 1. Now as they spoke to the people, the priests, the captain of the temple, and the Sadducees came upon them, being greatly disturbed that they taught the people and preached in Jesus the resurrection from the dead. And they laid hands on them, and they put them in custody until the next day, for it was already evening. Verse 4, however, many of those who heard the word believed, and the number of men came to be about 5,000. Holy moly. Verse 5, and it came to pass on the next day that their rulers, elders, and scribes, as well as Annas, the high priest, and Caiaphas, John, and Alexander, and as many as were of the family of the high priest were gathered together at Jerusalem. And when they had set them in the midst, they asked, by what power or by what name have you done this? And then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers of the people and elders of Israel, if we this day are judged for a good deed done to a helpless man, by what means he has been made well, verse 10, let it be known to you all and to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man stands here before you whole. This is the stone which the builders rejected, which has become the chief cornerstone. Now is there salvation, or nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. And I'll continue. Verse 13, now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men, they marveled. And they realized that they had been with Jesus. That's awesome. Verse 14, and seeing the man who had been healed standing with them, they could say nothing against it. But when they had commanded them to go aside out of the council, they conferred among themselves, saying this, what shall we do to these men? For indeed, that a noble miracle has been done through them is evident to all who dwell in Jerusalem, and we cannot deny it. But so that it spreads no further among the people, let us severely threaten them, that from now on they speak to no man in this name. Verse 18, so they called them and commanded them not to speak at all, nor to teach in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John answered and said to them, whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you more than to God, you judge. For we cannot but speak the things which we have seen and heard. So when they had further threatened them, they let them go, finding no way of punishing them because of the people, since they all glorified God for what had been done. For the man was over 40 years old on whom this miracle of healing had been performed. And we'll stop there. And I'll pray again. Lord, Again, we open up your word so that we can know you. Not just to get to know the Bible, but so that we can get to know you. And Lord, I ask that your Holy Spirit would be in this room as 1 John says. Lord, the same anointing that is on me, the same anointing that is on Pastor David, the same anointing that is on these elders is on each of us. And we have no need for any man to teach us. Lord, we need you. Lord, and you have provided the church with apostles and teachers and pastors and elders. And that's awesome. Lord, and that helps. Lord, but every time a person gets up, Lord, we need to hear from you. Lord, we want to hear from you and what you're speaking to us. Life lessons and application, Lord, that's all good. But Lord, let us make application tonight from your word, the things that you want for each of us individually. Corporately, yes, but individually as well. And help us to meditate on your word. Lord, to focus our eyes and attention on it continually. Lord, and may there be fruit from that in our lives. We love you, God, and we praise you for everything you've done. We know that you're doing great things still. Man, the book of Acts is filled with so many great things. And the things that you continue to this day. Lord, so use us, men, as we surrender ourselves to you and speak to us tonight, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's read it again. Or at least some of it. And then we'll talk about it. Now as they spoke, this is verse 1 again, as they spoke to the people, the priest, the captain of the temple. So prior to this, in chapter 3, as Neil spoke last week, it says that a lame man was healed. So this is the guy who's standing or sitting out in the temple who has been lame for a long time. Peter and John fix their eyes on them. And this is one of my favorite stories in the scripture, you know, or my favorite historical accounts in scripture. Is them coming up to this man and looking and being like, hey, bro, we ain't got no money. But what we do have, we'll give you, and it's better than money. So straight, they look him in the eyes. They're like, get up and walk. And this guy does it. Jumping around, everybody sees it. So, of course, everyone's coming, and Peter is teaching this sermon. People are seeing it. And then all of a sudden, all of the leaders of the synagogue see this. And they're reminded of one who had been there before, whom they thought they silenced. They thought, we're done with this. We got him. He's out. He's a goner. We're not going to hear from him ever again. Yeah, maybe there'll be some like backlash, like for a little bit of time. You know, like there'll be some things happening, and we'll see like little tremors of the earthquake that was Jesus. But it's definitely not going to go any further than just some ripple effect. And the water will calm down again. But that's not the case. Now as they spoke, the people, the priests, the captain of the temple, and the Sadducees, they came upon them, being greatly disturbed that they taught the people and preached in the name of Jesus the resurrection from the dead. They did not like that, especially the Sadducees. Pastor David talks about it all the time. How do you know what the Sadducees believe? Anybody? I give you full permission right now. They didn't believe there was a resurrection, and that's why they were sad, you see? That's right. So that's how you always remember the difference between Pharisees and Sadducees. They didn't believe in the miracle stuff, the resurrection from the dead. So especially the Sadducees here, they're upset because they're teaching the resurrection from the dead. And they're saying, we saw it. We saw Jesus. We sat with him. We talked with him. Jesus is still alive. And not only that, but we're speaking through his power and through his resurrection power. Here's something cool, that our lives can be like that too. Anybody have coworkers who don't know the Lord, who don't believe in the resurrection, who don't believe that Jesus rose from the grave? Okay, well, our lives can be a witness of the power of the resurrection by the things that we do. Us being in the Word and having our lives transformed day by day is evidence of the resurrection. It's evidence of the power that God has over sin and hell and death and Satan. Because the hold that was once on us is now no longer there. So now we walk in the resurrection power. That's what sanctification is. That's what justification is. And that's what one day glorification will be. It's all based in the resurrection of Jesus. So as we live our life sanctified, which means holified, which means holy, which just means set apart. As we live our life set apart, what we're doing is we're showing forth the world the resurrection of Jesus. So, be encouraged. When you are living your life differently, that is showing the power of God in your life, and that's showing His resurrection. You don't necessarily have to defend the resurrection of Jesus as much as you just live it, because you living it is showing it. Now, I'm not saying don't defend it. Steve, did you talk about that on Sunday, the resurrection? Good. A little bit.
Jesus Christ fulfilled 300 prophecies.
Yeah, cool. Like, boom, you don't, like, that's good. But living your life as well, you know, it's like a two-edged sword, you know. You got your life and you got your words, your deeds and your words, and you're cutting people all the time with those things. It's not in a bad way, but in a good way, in the power of the Spirit. So verse 3, and they laid hands on them. Okay, not like we lay hands when we pray for you, you know, but they laid hands, pulled them away, and put them into custody until the next day. They're like, we got to stop this. So they're like freaking out. So they do brash things. They lay hands on them until the next day, for it was already evening. So like, it's 5 o'clock, you know, our work day is over. Let's just hold them till tomorrow at 9 a.m. We'll do this again. All right, verse 4. However, many of those who heard the word believed, and the number of the men came to be about 5,000. So it didn't matter that they stopped them, because what had been done had already been done. They'd already shown forth the resurrection. Peter had already convinced 5,000 people of the resurrection of Christ, and that their lives were worth giving up for him. In verse 5, and it came to pass on the next day that their rulers, elders, and scribes, as well as, it's hard to say his name because you want to say something else, but it's, I guess it's Annas. I'm not going to say the other thing that I want to say. The high priest, Caiaphas, and John, and Alexander, and as many as were of the family of the high priest were gathered together at Jerusalem. And when they had set them in the midst, they asked, by what power, by what name have you done this? So basically, you got Peter and John coming before these highly qualified, in men's eyes, men who are like the big dogs in Judaism, who are the big dogs of the time, who you don't come against. What they say goes. Everybody knows it. So they bring out the big dogs, and they're like, what do you think you're doing? Who do you think you are coming in here acting like this? What they were doing was an actual confronting of what they had done. They said, we silenced Jesus, and now you're speaking and preaching in his name? Who do you think you are that you're doing this? By what power, by what authority, by what name have you done this? They probably shouldn't have asked what name, because they were asking for it there. Then Peter, filled again with the Holy Spirit, as Neil talked about last week, the power of the Holy Spirit to change Peter into the man that he had become, someone who was bold and walking in the power of the resurrection. He says, rulers and the people, or of the people, and elders of Israel. And this is just like common sense what he says here. I love it. Verse 9, if we this day are judged for a good deed done to a helpless man, by what means he has been made well? Like, I can see Peter as he's talking, he's going like, this is insane to me that we're in trouble right now for this. This is blowing my mind This guy right here that you're talking to us about is walking around doing awesome things, and you're straight bold-faced denying it. If we're being judged by helping this man, let it be known to all of you, like, you guys are insane right now. Let it be known to every one of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, by what name? You unsmart guys. Why did you ask what name are you doing this? It's like, come on. By the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man stands here before you whole. This reminds me of what Paul speaks of, and this is like essential to Christianity. I don't know if we're going to talk about that in equipping the saints, but the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Was that one of the three, Steve, that you gave? I shouldn't talk about something I don't know what I'm talking about, right? But the resurrection of Jesus Christ, it's cornerstone, it's foundational, and Pastor David has spoke about it many times, that the cornerstone of the Christian faith is the resurrection. And you see every time they're opening their mouths, they're talking about the resurrection, that Jesus rose from the grave. They're not trying to skirt it, they're not trying to go around it, but they are boldly proclaiming that Jesus rose from the dead, that God raised him from the dead. And it's by this man who is not dead, but still living, still breathing, still working. You guys killed him, but he's still living. It's by this man that this man stands before you whole. And then they talk about Jesus more from Psalm 122 or 118, 22. It says, "This is the stone which the builders rejected, which has become the chief cornerstone." They say this was, and this was one of the things that Steve talked about. I know because he just said it. The prophecies that Jesus fulfilled. This was a prophecy fulfilled by Jesus that Israel, the builders, would reject the cornerstone, and they would reject his resurrection. They would reject who he was. The foundation of all of Judaism, the foundation of God's promise, was the anointed one who came to save us sinners. The foundation. It's what everything else is built on. You don't have even Judaism without the foundation of the coming Messiah. And you definitely don't have the foundation of Christianity without the Messiah. As we know, it should have been a clear change up, like Judaism into Christianity. You know, it should have been just a continually following. And the whole time, I mean, it was supposed to be the Jewish people showing the world this promise of the coming one and bringing people in. But they failed at that because of their pride. And sometimes we fell at that because of our pride. But this is the stone which you guys rejected. And the scriptures wrote about it. David, the psalmist, wrote about it, which has become the chief cornerstone. And now, because of his resurrection, he is the chief cornerstone. And it's what everything else is built upon. If you don't have Jesus, you have nothing. It's him and him alone. Nor is there salvation in any other. And Jesus said that in John 14:6. I am the way, the truth, in the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. Nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. I think maybe what they were asking, and we can talk about this later, is by what name, by what authority, is like, what rabbi did you come under? What school of rabbinical thought did you come under? Where are you doing this? Why are you doing this? How are you doing this? Like, by what authority do you have to do this? And they're saying, by Jesus. Because there's salvation in no other name. There's freedom from sin in no other name. There's deliverance of bodily ailment in no other name than Jesus. And he's the only one who can save us. That reminds me of, you remember the Jesus as he's in the house, and then the friends bring the lame man in the bed. And They bring them, and then they lower them because they couldn't fit them. And then Jesus looks at this guy, and he's like, they're like, heal him, heal him. And he's like, okay, your sins are forgiven you. And he heals him. And the Pharisees and the Sadducees are like, who does this guy think he is? And Jesus looked at them, and he said, you marvel at the fact that I said your sins are forgiven? And this man's walking? And he was showing at the same time this, that both things were impossible. He's like, which one's more impossible? And the real answer was both of them are impossible for real men to do. Or not real men, but men to do outside of the power of the Holy Spirit, outside of God moving. You can't heal somebody. Raise your hand in here if you can heal somebody in your own power. Raise your hand if you have the power to forgive somebody. You don't. Only God has those two powers. And Jesus is like, I got both of those powers. So I'm going to show you that I have power to forgive by showing you that I have power over the physical body. So in Jesus raising this man up and giving him power to walk, he not only showed that he had power over that, but he showed that he had power to forgive sin as well. And so in the very same thing, this is what the disciples are doing. In the very same way, they're walking in the footsteps of Jesus. They're showing Jesus still has power over death. And not only that, but not only in his name is this guy walking around, but also in this his name, this man can be saved. And 5,000 people who saw it are saved. Wow. Verse 13, and this is definitely one of my favorite scriptures, verses. It says this, now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, they perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men. That's my favorite, because I can relate to that. I'm like, untrained and uneducated. And it shows sometimes, you know, it's like, whew, it's a struggle. And it shows this, that you don't have to be educated. You don't have to be trained in any way. The most important thing for us, and maybe this is like the biggest life lesson of all for us, is the biggest life lesson for all of us is spend time with Jesus. Spend time with Jesus. Hang out with him. Be in the Word. Be in prayer. Get to know who he is from the Scriptures. Ask him to be beside of you. It's the most important thing, but it's like the one thing that we sometimes don't find time for. I always like the story that Pastor David shares about if you woke up tomorrow morning and you were running out your door, alarm clock sounded, you're getting ready, you're dressed, you're like, okay, I got to get out the door. And as you're getting out the door, you turn around, you look, and at the dining room table, I don't know where the dining room table is in your house, but it's like sitting right there inside your house is Jesus, and he's sitting there. What would you do? The first time you ever seen him, like real eye to face to face, would you close the door and walk out and be like, bro, I got to work. I don't get time for this. I'll see you when I get home. Would you push him off? Or would you be like, you know what? I'm going to call my work, and I'm going to say, yeah, I'm not going to come in today. Which one are you going to do? If you actually saw Jesus sitting at your table, you'd call out of work. Yeah, you'd be like, this is bunk. I'm not doing that. Right? Tomorrow morning, when you get up and you begin to go to work or do whatever you do, as you are going out of your door and as you're about to close it, I want you to turn around and realize that Jesus has been there the whole time. And that you have an opportunity every day to spend time with him and to see your life radically transformed and for people to look at your life and marvel. And that's exactly what Peter said in 1 Peter when he said, but sanctify the Lord Jesus in your heart. Set Jesus apart in your heart. Have a special place for him in your heart. Spend time with him. Make him the number one thing. And then when people look at you and they see all your good works, they see the hope that is inside of you, then you'll have an answer for them. They'll ask you for the reason for the hope that's in you. And you'll be able to defend it. And you'll be able to say, Jesus, I was spending time with Jesus. And people will look at you and be like, man, there's something different. And what is it? It's spending time with Jesus. It's not getting into these deep books of theology or whatever. It's spending time with Jesus, number one. Those are all helpful. And I'm not saying don't do those. I'm not looking down on you if you do those, because I do those. I love it. But it's spend time with Jesus. If you have time for nothing else, spend time with him. And then people will look at you and do this as well. And they realize that they had been with Jesus. Not only did they realize that they had been with Jesus, but then it was just like plain put, as Peter said. And seeing the man who had been healed standing with them, they could say nothing against it. So their words were not only words, but they were backed up by deeds. They weren't just speaking the truth, but they were living out the truth. And seeing the man who had been healed standing with them, they could say nothing against it. But when they had commanded them to go aside out of the council, they conferred among themselves, saying, what shall we do to these men? They're like, okay. They're like picking their brains. They're like, okay, what do we do? Okay, we're all pretty smart guys in here. How do we shut them up? What shall we do to these men? For indeed, that a noble miracle has been done through them is evident to all who dwell in Jerusalem. We cannot deny it. But so that it spreads no further among the people, let us severely threaten them. Let's threaten them. Let's say we'll do something to them if they don't stop. I mean, and that's not an empty threat too, right? Because previously what happened? Jesus. They murdered Jesus. So let's threaten them severely. And that worked the first time, right? Because what happened to the disciples? They scattered abroad. They're like, we're out of here. Aren't you with them? No, I'm not with them. Little girl comes up. Aren't you with them? No, I'm not with them. I'm scared of you, little girl. It's like, come on, bro. Let us severely threaten them. But here's the thing. They didn't realize that they had encountered the resurrection of Jesus. So it turns out that that still was an empty threat to these men, because they had a hope of the resurrection, because they saw with their eyes that Jesus had risen. So this, again, is an empty threat to them. So what if you take my life? They're like, so what if you take my life? The disciples showed up several times. So what if you take my freedom? So what if you take my money? So what if you take my transportation? So what if you take this? So what if you take this? Whatever you take from me, I don't care. Because I will forever have the hope of the resurrection. And there's something that you'll never be able to take from me. And that is life eternal, lived not only in quantity of life, but in quality of life. And I'm not saying like that you're going to have everything perfect, but I'm saying that you're going to have a deep down hope inside. And that's something that Peter and John had. So as these guys are saying, let's severely threaten them. This time they didn't run scared. This time they saw the resurrection of Jesus and they said, you know what, we'll have that too. And they have the power of the Holy Spirit. Let's severely threaten them that from now on they speak to no man in this name. So they called them and they commanded them not to speak at all, nor to teach in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John answered and said to them, this is boldness right here, guys. This is so good. And it's just really plain. It's like, no duh, this is what you're supposed to answer. Whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you more than to God? Okay, because God told us to do this. You be the judge. to speak of the things that we have heard. Okay, let's see. I'm sorry, I skipped that. Listen to you more than to God, you judge. For we cannot but speak the things which we have seen and heard. And what had they seen and heard? They had seen the resurrection of Jesus. They had heard him speak. And now they were walking in it. And they were proclaiming only what was true. Sometimes whenever I think about persecution of Christians, I think about, like, imagine you were saying that this Bible is the color black. And everyone around you was saying, no, this is the color blue. And they had a gun to your head and they were saying, this is the color blue, admit it. And you're like, it's definitely not the color blue, it's black. This is as true as it can be. This is black. I have evidence for it. I know it. Not only do I have evidence scientifically, but I have evidence experientially. Like, I know this color is black. I know. And no matter what you do, this is black. Sometimes I feel like that's... A lot of people sometimes say, like... I don't know if I'd be able to last in persecution. And I'm like, well, I mean, I think you will be able to if you were ever put up to that, because the Holy Spirit's going to give you power. But also, you're speaking the truth. You're speaking what you know is true. And it's, you can't deny the truth. Well, you can deny it, I guess, if you're... Anyway, I don't know why I said that. But so that it spreads no further. Let's see this. So they called them, but Peter and John answered, whether it's right in your sight or in God's sight, you be the judge. For we cannot speak but the things that we've seen and heard. So when they had further threatened them, they let them go. That's all they could do was threaten them. Oh, that's not all they could do, but that's what they did. Finding no way of punishing them because of the people. So that's the answer. They were walking in fear of the people, in fear of losing the fame and the name that they had made for themselves. So because they feared the people and not God, they let them go, since they all glorified God for what had been done. You know, eventually in Acts we'll read about Gamaliel and how he looks at them all and he's like, guys, you should just stop. Let's just stop bugging these guys. And let's just say this, if it is of God, then it'll stay. If it's not of God, then it'll go. That's what always happens, is these things, they like happen and then they will out, you know? For the man, and this is kind of a crazy thing that's in this account, is it says this, for the man was over 40 years old on whom this miracle of the healing had been performed. It says he was 40 years old. So I guess it says this because everybody saw him every day for 40 years. They had seen this guy standing there, or rather sitting there. And they're like, we know this guy. This isn't just like something somebody made up. Like, they didn't meet in Galilee and they were like, hey, let's do this little trick when we get to Jerusalem this year. When we get there, let's act like you were lame and let's go heal it. And after everybody gives us their money and we get all this fame, we'll meet back in Galilee, we'll split it. It wasn't like that. It was like this guy was there all the time. Everybody saw him for 40 years. Well, he was 40 years old. I don't know how long he actually sat there, but the healing had been performed. So that's the end of what we'll talk about today in Acts chapter 4. But whenever I read Acts chapter 4, I'm blown away by the boldness of Peter and John in the midst of what they were actually facing. And that was something that I think can be accredited to three things. They had spent time with Jesus. They experienced the resurrection of Christ. And they had the power of the Holy Spirit. And those were three things that I think are essential in this text that we could also benefit from. Number one, spend time with Jesus. Let's evaluate ourselves and let's think about this. Number one, am I spending time with Jesus? And I'm evaluating myself as well. Am I spending time with Jesus? Whenever people see me, when people have conversation with me, are they seeing that I spend time with Jesus? I can definitely say this, that when people hang out with me, they can tell that I've been hanging out with Kimberly because I begin to act like her, because I begin to do things like she does them, because I begin to ask questions like she asks questions, because I'm like, man, I can learn from that, you know? Like, she's my spouse, she benefits me, I benefit her, I grow from her, she grows from me. I even take some bad things from her, but you're not gonna take any bad things from Jesus, so don't worry about that, all right? So, as people hang out with me, they're like, man, you're changing, you're a married man now, like, you're not as crazy as you used to be. And I'm like, well, yeah, that kinda happens, because all those crazy things that I did were sometimes kinda stupid, and she balances me out. Same thing with any relationship, but specifically right now with Jesus. Are you spending time with him? Because that will show through in your words, in your actions. And that's what we want. Number two, are you walking in the power of the resurrection? Are you convinced of the resurrection of Jesus Christ? Are you convinced that no matter what happens, take my freedom, take my health, take whatever, that you have hope and a future, no matter what?
You know, I think that's important too, because if they did not see that, they wouldn't have had that hope, you know. So if you have doubt in that second part right there, mm-hmm. it's not going to give you that what you need, you know, that you have.
Right. Yeah, and it's like, so what? Whatever happens. Like, even if, like, we all have, like, these grandeur, like, plans, like, hopes of the future, where we're like, this is going to happen. But it's like, even if that didn't happen, we rejoice because our name is written in the book of life. We rejoice because, and we know it's true, because Jesus did it first. And as the scriptures say, he's the first fruits of many to come after him. Because Jesus rose from the grave, we'll rise from the grave. And this life is just like a rope. And it goes on forever. And we always focus on this little thing right here. I saw that from Francis Chan. He has this little thing that he does. And it's like this much. This is life in the spectrum of like eternity. And we always focus right here. But as Christians, we get that flipped now. Now the things that happen here aren't as big as they used to be, because this isn't all we got. We got all of this, and we're sowing into eternity. And then that third thing, the Holy Spirit. Are you walking in the Holy Spirit power? Are you being filled with the Holy Spirit? Are you walking in his power? And those are three things. Spend time with Jesus, hope of the resurrection, and Holy Spirit power. And with that, let's pray. Lord, you are awesome. You are a good, good God. And your word is so good. And we're so happy, God, that we get to walk. We get to walk in your truth. We get to walk in your love. We get to walk in your power. Thank you, God, that you showed that you had power over death when you rose from the grave. And the same power that rose you from the grave, Lord, is in us today. And through the Holy Spirit power, we have access. And not only that, God, but thank you that because of your resurrection, you live today. And tomorrow morning, as we wake up, tonight, as we lay down to sleep, you're right there. And we can spend time with you. Lord, many of us have Bibles, probably plethoras of Bibles, where we can spend time with you, getting to know you, and hanging out with you so much that you begin to rub off on us. Lord, that's what we want. Because we know that that's the only way that we can impact this world. That's the only way we can impact our families. That's the only way that we can have a beneficial impact at our workplace. Lord, and that's the only way we can have a beneficial impact in random people that we meet. So Lord, make us contagious like you are. As we spend time with you, when people spend time with us, may that rub off on them. And as we're filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, our cups are overflowing, pouring into other people. Help us to continue that train, which is exactly what Peter and John did. And 5,000 people around came to know you. Wow. Lord, that's what we want. Lives lived in purpose because of your resurrection. So I thank you for your word. Thank you for these men. Bless them this week. And I pray that through all this, your Holy Spirit will continue to speak to them. In Jesus' name, amen.